BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Welcome this evening to a New Arts program in which we will sing the work of Ted Ormai. And Ted is does some very exciting work. And the first thing that I'm going to do is have him talk about the tool and the material that he uses in arriving at his conclusions or his work. And I want him to be able to set that in motion, and then we can go in to see some of his work, because it's not like anything else you've seen, the way in which he puts together the tools and the fluid materials. Go ahead, Ted. It's
okay.
Yours.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on your show, or back on your show. I was here 10 years ago when I had another show at the New Arts Program. So this is sort of a continuation of that, my work in what I call magnetics. I don't know if it's totally unique, but it's not something you'd learn in art school. This is a combination of painting, drawing, printing, maybe a little 3D sculpture, and printing, a little bit of printing sort of too.
Most of what you've got in your exhibition though is where you're taking the fluid and you're using the tool.
Yes.
Which is...
I'm using magnetism as one of my inputs, and it's a material and an inspiration. So the patterns that appear, they're compared to celestial objects, which, you know, magnetism is holding the whole universe together, and I'm doing these works in a magnetic field, but in gravity too, that we're all living in all the time.
Everything you have is a magnet to create those things.
Yeah, I've used permanent magnets, and it does transfer some of the magnetism to the piece. So I'm part of the input, and the magnets are part of the input, and it's
and the other element is the paint.
Oh yeah,
you use magnetic
paints that are attracted to magnetism, so they have some element of iron, nickel, cobalt, or something that's magnetic, and it either attracts or repels them and creates these patterns, which mostly are circular patterns. And I'm not always working on flat surfaces, so they're sort of a cross section, but the fact that they're curved allegedly the universe is curved too.
What do you call them? The surfaces.
Well, what are they painted on? Are they
yes? Besides canvas.
Oh, I use some of these are unprimed, unstretched canvases, and some of them are on satellite receiving dishes that are curved surfaces. Not all of them, but a lot of them you'll see. The outcome is unknown when I'm starting on them. I have an idea from working over the years, probably the last 20 some years doing this, so I have an idea what's going to show up, but never quite sure because I don't do it the same way. But one leads to the next one, and I kind of learned as I go. But you know, some of it's things that I've learned from studying art and going to museums and galleries and talking to a lot of artists.
Your colors that you use, do all oil or acrylic or any paint, or do all the companies have lead or have
iron
magnetic qualities in them? Or I know that you use gold and acrylic.
Yeah, no, I've used a lot of acrylics, maybe not totally exclusively, but Mark Golden from Golden Paints came to visit years ago and asked what people were interested in. I told him magnetism, and he suggested a couple of their paints. Micatacious iron is one of them. It has a spectral hematite in it, which even though the mica is not magnetic, it sort of moves with the iron. And Mars Black is an iron-based paint. These pigments are, some of them are iron-based. And I also use rust, which is iron oxide. I kind of make my own paint. And he said they demagnetize the paint when they want to keep it from clumping or something, but I go backwards. I remagnetize it and create the patterns.
Okay, I think
this maybe
is
I can.
I think this is very important for when you they see this that there is the magnet and that even on the canvas as well as on the metal
right.
surfaces.
I set up the environment with the magnetism, usually underneath the work, and I'm working horizontally. And some of them use a lot of liquid. I mean, they're flowing shapes. So the gravity is moving the paint around too, as well as the magnetism through the fields.
And that you use a metal, again, it's magnetic.
Right, magnetic. Most of the satellite receiving dishes are metal. So they're transferring, and part of what happened in what I was working towards in this exhibition was moving into a different scale. Limited by the size of the magnets that I had available, it took me a while to figure out that I could take 10 magnets, 20 magnets, and put them together on a big steel plate disc, and that I would end up with a bigger magnet by adding them all together.
In other words, more power.
Well, larger size works instead of limiting by the actual size of each magnet. All right, we're going to start here when they enter the gallery. This is the New Arts Program, 173 West Main Street in Kutztown.
Yes.
James's home base for the last 50 years,
and
anniversary.
The exhibition is open on Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays from 10 to 1, but also anytime during the week from 10 to 1, you can call or knock on the door, and 99% of the time I'm there. So it's open 7 days a week, so to speak.
All right, you're looking into the room here and you see the largest piece, but I want to get you acclimated with the space because the scale of these things, when you look at each one individually and they're round on a full screen, they kind of all look the same size if they're taking up the whole screen. But in reality, there's a lot of different sizes. And the satellite dishes, I've got a number of different companies, and they're not all the same shape. And they're not really round. They're parabolic dishes, and they're usually oval.
Now, the largest one is right straight ahead here.
Yes, that's
on canvas.
8 feet tall. The canvas is 8 feet tall, and the disc is about 6 feet. Here's a few more. Take a little tour around the gallery. And these are the ones that I used rust, iron oxide, as the pigment primarily, and some clear acrylics. Once the patterns are established, then I sort of fix them in place with thinned down acrylics, and then they're permanent. And they're unframed and unstretched, so they can be rolled up. I mean, this is another thing, like how do you move these? Because some of them, when I would add powdered metal to them, they're sort of delicate. And here you can see some of the dishes. They actually extend out from the wall. And the pieces are held on to the wall with magnets, not the same magnet that created them, but just as a attaching device on the back. All right, now we're looking back out towards the entrance. This large one, I mean, it's hard to not identify it as a sun or some kind of glowing object. And you'll see later in the presentation that they actually do glow. This is phosphorescent paint that is glowing in the light. But they retain some of the energy and glow in the dark for a while. And the smaller one also. It's sort of opaque and translucent. And then the outer part is a wash that has, it's an acrylic wash on top of the iron oxides that is, it's kind of a glitter, transparent glitter that has a color shift. As you look at it or walk by it, it goes from a greenish to yellowish, depending on how the light is hitting it. And this happens in gemstones like opals, and just how the plane of the, mostly I think it's mica, that, but it aligns in the magnetic fields. And the curved ones, as you walk by them, since it's not a flat surface, you're always getting some of the reflection on part of the curve. And those change as you go by also. Now, this is one of the first large-scale pieces that I did. And like I said, these are on unprimed, unstretched canvas. Originally, this was square. And from having it, this one took me, I had it outside and took several months over the summer for this material to rust in the shape. And it was getting rained on, and I kept spraying it to get the metal to rust. But the canvas, the warp and the weft, I guess, are made out of different things, so it stretched irregularly. So something that ended up, that started as square, shrank.
But you wouldn't know it.
No, I didn't know it at the time. I just thought, oh, I'll start with a square thing, square.
Only when you measured it.
Well, I noticed that it wasn't square anymore, and it was like, over 6 feet, it shrank a couple inches more in one direction than the other. But that was, hey, that's the way it worked. But it also buckles the canvas, too, and all those irregularities was something that I saw happening. And I wasn't trying to keep it 100% flat, so I took advantage of that in some of the later ones. Here you can see the canvas, even though it's coated with acrylic, it's still flexible. And these particles were powdered iron, so I'm doing these horizontally, so it's sort of like a sand painting. I'm sprinkling the sand into the magnetic field, and they they stick where the magnetic field is stronger, unless it's a situation where they're repelled out of the area. And there's a characteristic of electricity and magnetism, which is sort of the electromagnetic spectrum, they're sort of perpendicular to each other and convert back and forth. One of the characteristics is that the energy seems to go to the edges, and when electricity goes down a wire, it goes around the outside of the wire. It doesn't go through the center of the wire. So I discovered these things, and then I sort of used them in my next, like this piece, and I realized that the flow going out of it created these patterns which are flowing patterns, but they also look like flames. And then this one, I excluded anything from the center and just sealed that with acrylic. But this, you can see this as it's happening and the particles moving around. So it's something that you're participating in it. And the acrylic dries pretty fast. So, and like I said, some of these I do them in the summer when it's hot, especially the ones that are on metal. I can get them to dry very fast and do layers. And the clear acrylic acts as like a resist or a block, so the it won't stain those areas that have already been sealed. Another smaller one, that this one is an individual magnet that some of the rust and iron oxide pigments is usually reddish, but some iron oxides are yellow, and black is another iron, like black iron pipe. that won't rust any further, or you can convert, you can stop rust with some chemicals that turn it into the black iron. I found there's 16 different varieties of iron, and iron that's found around Berks County is actually called magnetite. I guess it's a bit magnetic, or all iron is, but I mean, that's how they discovered magnets are naturally occurring forms of iron, lodestones they're called. So I'm extending beyond the magnet, which if you walked into a room with a compass, you could detect the magnetic fields, and I'm sure with more sensitive instruments, or they're getting information from other planets or way out in the solar system. So this is really local kind of magnetism, but it drops off very fast further you get away from the actual source. But here you can see some of the acrylics that I've used and leave part of it untreated and seal part of it. So things act in different ways. This is an earlier piece that I think this is 1997 that I had done on paper. But since it's kind of a lot more fragile, I had to frame it and put it under glass, and to me that all kind of got in the way. That's why I decided I'd rather just have it open and figured out some ways of making it so it's not so delicate. But here you can see the watery effects that things are flowing around. Even though they're held in place by the magnetic field, that edge is really defined, and if you're using any kind of brushes that have metal tips on them, you can feel the magnetism. I mean, it's the metal brush. It's not that I have any kind of extra sensory perception with the magnetism, although some people say that birds and bees orient through magnetism, allegedly, and maybe some people. I'm not quite sure of that. Now here again, you can see some of the scale. Now this is one of the pieces that uses the phosphorescent glow-in-the-dark paint, and I'll show a little later. But a lot of people have said that these look like eyes, which is kind of obvious, maybe. But the optical effect is either concave or convex, even though this one is actually flat. But the optical illusion is that there's some depth that's receding or radiating out, or black holes, which would be sucking in all kinds of light and energy. But that's a magnetic pattern, all those radiating lines. And I'm just emphasizing certain parts of them and getting these effects. Now, so these are some of the ones that are on metal and on concave satellite receiving dishes. This piece is called Wild Blue Yonder. It's an illusion of space. I mean, there actually is some depth to it, but certainly not infinite depth. And it's not all just being created by any kind of techniques. I mean, this is the same image you could get if you took a picture of a nova or something that's is in infinite space, and the scale of it is much smaller, but it sort of alludes to vastness. And here you can see a little bit of the change in, as you would walk by it, you get different areas that, these are iridescent paints, and but since it's a curved surface, depends on how you look at it, you're always getting some of the reflection back. And here you can see some of the underpainting. I use black gesso, and a lot of artwork, people start with a white canvas. And I was painting things black, and then I discovered they actually make black gesso. So somebody else must be using it. And I think that is an iron-based paint, too. Probably that Mars black. So the brush strokes shine through. And since it's curved, gravity's pulling the paint down as the magnets are affecting it also. This one is called Wild Blue. Now this satellite receiving dish was given to me by Patricia Johansson, who saw that I did work with satellite dishes and had one. That was the name of the company, Wild Blue. That was painted on, stenciled on this thing. And that's, I think it's satellite internet service. And this is before Starlink, which I looked at their dishes are sending and receiving. So they're much more complex. And I think they have 8 layers on them. And since these are parabolic, the shape that forms in the center of it is an oval. It's not a circle, and it's in it's perpendicular to the axis of the dish. Because I've removed the microwave pickup that's getting the signal. I'm just using the curved shape. This is a previous one that had, this has some glow in the dark paint on the front, but it's, this one is a flat one, but I guess it has some dimensional qualities. Yeah, that centerpiece is a ready-made shape, the circle that came out of a, like when paint skins over in a can. This is a pint. I've got some that are quarts and some that are gallons, different shapes, but it's like thick. And I just put them on the work and then start around that as like a ready-made circle shape. Another one that's painted on metal, where the shininess of the metal is coming through, which is actually better than white underpainting, painting on chrome. So they're not flat.
It almost looks like bronze, doesn't it?
Well, all the patinas of the metals, yeah. Blues are usually associated with copper. And I sort of limited my palette in the blues in this series. They were done over a number of years, but I for the show, I put all the blue ones together. Another one that's done on a dish. And these dishes are not all the same size and the same ratio, height to width. Different companies have different designs, or they've gotten smaller and smaller over the years. You don't need a 12-foot dish anymore to get signals in your house. And that's mica, the part that's all speckly like stardust. Here's one that's a little deeper dish, and this is more symmetrical. And you can see that it's held onto the wall by a magnet, not the magnet that it was created with, but it's projecting out of the wall approximately a foot. And you get all those interesting shadows too, but it's scooping up light and bouncing it around inside the dish. And this originally, these concentric patterns were created when I was making my own rust. I had water in here, and as it evaporated, it got into more and more tighter circles and created this texture. And later I added the paint, and this was in a magnetic field as it happened. And it went over a period of time, and they're in my studio over the winter, so there was freezing and thawing, and I think the magnets were not all in the same place always. Another smaller piece, painted on metal. And you're looking back into the underpainting, which sometimes looks like it's projecting out and sometimes looks like it's heading in into infinite space. And here you can see as you walk by it how the iridescence changes. Another one similar, and this has some phosphorescent paint on it that glows in the dark too. And somebody who saw this thought it was, even though this one's flat, they thought it was a bowl, because people in ceramics use these kind of techniques of round things, and so they, when they first saw this, they were thinking that it was painted inside a bowl. Now, they're not all blue. I've tried a couple other colors, and different shapes. And different angles. When you go by an apartment building or you see satellite dishes attached to people's houses, sometimes they're really in weird angles attached to the side of the building, or they're pointing at geosynchronous satellites, so they're pointing in the same direction, but the building that they're attached to might not be ideal. Or if they're different companies, sometimes they're pointing in several different directions for different satellites. This is an earlier piece that was done with a magnet on canvas, and I was getting some of the effects and using very thin down iridescence. and letting the magnets move things around. It led into this piece, which was done with gold leaf. And it definitely, when you look at it, it's hard to tell whether it's positive or negative or in or out because of the black, which is sort of like space. And rarely is a circle, unless you look at it directly, it's going to turn into an oval if you look at it on an angle and a perspective. But the underpainting shows through. If you have any imperfections, it's becomes more and more obvious any layers you put on them. But I use that. I don't try to fight it. And the wrinkles and irregularities. Here you can see that the oval is perpendicular to the outside oval. And these small circles that look like moons or something, satellites orbiting, they're what used to hold the microwave microphones onto. Mostly I remove them and fill in the holes. This one I thought I'd just leave them, and it became another element. These, like I said, it's been said that they look like eyes, so I put them side by side. These were done simultaneously, even though I use the same materials, but one magnet is positive and the other magnet is the negative side of it. Not sure which one's which, but they produce different effects. And this this gold and reddish oxide is a technique that you see in Renaissance art. They underpaint gold with red. Somehow it makes it more vibrant, or it gives it a surface to work on. And you can see the how the gradients were formed by the strength, different strengths of the magnet. And this is the other side. And I say, I'm not sure which one's which. You could check it out by using a compass, and whatever it points to, it's the opposite of whatever the compass says. And also I found out a strange thing. The Chinese who discovered the compass thousands of years ago, in their orientation, they always talk about the compass pointing towards the south. It's the same axis, but their emphasis is on the south rather than the north. And I asked a Chinese person, contemporary, and they say, yeah, that's the way they do it. And if you buy some magnets, they are some compasses, they're going to tell you the opposite because they're made in China. And here we go with a green glow. And you can see that the black pigment on top of it is being repelled out of the field and creating those same, could be fractal, I'm not sure what you, because they work on all different scales, but you always end up with the same shapes. And some of these smaller discs are where I filled in the holes for those rivets that were holding the microphones on. And even though I filled them in and painted over them, the magnetism detects any anomalies in the structure, and that's used in, there's powdered pigments that are used, magnetic pigments that are used industrially to detect cracks in vessels or like engine blocks for that same principle where the magnetism seems to concentrate on edges or cracks. So it would show up if there's any invisible flaws. They go right through the paint and show any discontinuous material underneath them. Now here's the large one that we started with when I turned the lights out. This is a commercial glow-in-the-dark paint, and I used almost a quart of paint painting this layer after layer. And in the background, you can see the smaller one. And it fades out, but I read that there are some, it will last up to 12 hours. And here's the smaller one, which is, I think this is golden glow-in-the-dark paint that the green seems to be the most intense. They had a blue, but they discontinued it. They couldn't get the pigments anymore. I'm not sure why. But this, you can see how it changes. And this one I've had in my house, and you walk by it at night, it's there. You can see it. It's this one holds on. And I just heard today, I saw something on the internet, you can get glow-in-the-dark tattoos. I guess they're made out of ink that glows in the dark. And there's, who knows? I mean, I haven't seen one yet. But it fades out. Even you can see the camera readjusted itself as the light intensity changed. So we can do a little bit of a review here back in the gallery. You can see on the floor there's a circle. That's a Keith Haring drawing in the studio at the New Arts Program. He did that in what year was that? In the 80s sometime?
87.
Yeah, there's a circle there. And people have been using circles forever. I mean, they've been looking at the sun and the moon, and it's not just geometric art. And these radiating lines, Keith Haring used those in, I mean, they come from cartoons, little expressions or energy. The radiating baby, I guess, is the most famous one. But I just thought of that as an afterthought that, I mean, these are line drawings, so it's kind of a different thing, but they're expressing things that are beyond the edges of the, or vibrations, movement. And although these are static, they might convey some movement. So yeah, the show runs until May 14th, and
that's
a Sunday, and we'll have some kind of a closing reception or a last minute viewing for anybody who wants to come and see it. And it's 10 till 1, but we might stay open a little longer that day.
if we do, we'd be going to two.
Yeah. So I don't know. What did I miss?
Did you forget anything?
Oh, probably. But I just want to talk about the scale. We go back to some of these. They're larger than human scale. I mean, this one's 8 feet tall, and the circle is 6 feet, which is, you know, I guess sort of human. And you can say they're about empty space or nothing, voids, which is kind of a Zen thing. I've also called them hex signs, or local version of circular patterns. Actually, I'm looking out the window here. Alvernia University has a hex sign as their logo. But people in a lot of different cultures have used circular forms. So I am tapping into a lot of these different things. And, you know, pictures that I've seen in our age that have come from, well, now it's the Hubble or the Webb, but any picture that was taken from space is kind of new to our time. So, I mean, people have been, any kid who draws a picture usually puts the sun in there, or, you know, it's horizon, the sun, and you got a picture. I do call these landscapes, some of these. And once again, you can see some of the scale of these.
The one thing I find within your work is with the metal surface and with the canvas, they have a common denominator to me as being very grainy, the surface.
Right, because there are little particles that are moving around.
That you have no control over, theoretically.
I'm cooperating with the magnets, and hopefully they're cooperating with me. But it's, you know, you can arrange the fields in different ways or have magnets that are outside of your frame that are actually affecting what's going on in there, distorting it. I mean, that's how they discovered some of the planets. They knew something must be there because it was pulling other things out of orbits. So eventually they got the instruments that were sensitive enough to detect these things.
Well, somewhat what they look like, the surface, having those qualities, is like time elements, the element of time eating itself into it.
Okay,
yes.
Okay, good. Yeah, all right. Some of them do take some time, and I've tried to get some techniques that I can, like I made my own rust. Instead of waiting weeks or months for it to rust, I had powdered rust that I could, like the one with the flowing edges, that was powder flowing in the magnetic field, so it moved around in a different way. I mean, I buy commercial paint, and somebody told me there's magnetic paint. The paint itself is magnetic. And I re-magnetize it, but there's paint that I'm not sure what it's used for, but...
Have you ever gotten it?
No, I haven't tried it yet. I mean, there's...
Who sells it?
I'm not sure. I think Rust-Oleum makes one. Doesn't seem like it would be strong enough to hold more than a piece of paper, but maybe that's what they're trying to hold, is a piece of paper. I'm sure there's plenty of questions, but can review here again a little bit, go backwards.
That's one of the strongest ones.
Yes.
Part of it's the black surface, I guess, that's making it more intensified.
And this one, the name of this one is Nocturnal Hex. I mean, hex signs are out there day and night on the side of the barn, but you usually can't see them. And they're, culturally for good luck or to keep away bad luck. So repelling and attracting is part of the folk myth in our local area.
That's a big one.
This is the largest that I knew would fit in the gallery because I brought it there when I did it to photograph it. And I was glad for the opportunity to show these. I've been accumulating them for a while, and the situation came up where the show was canceled, and this is actually going to be the last individual show at the New Arts Program before we have the small work show. And then next year will be the 50th anniversary, reviewing some of the work that's...
Well, there'll be three different exhibitions. The first one is in the fall, which is covering artists of materials that we have that they did from September to December of 23. And then the second show will be the artists that we have work of that goes from 2000 to, no, that goes from 1982 to 1999, and then it's then in the 20th century we have covering from 1900 to the present covering work.
2000.
Who's that?
2000? Not 19.
To 2000.
To present.
Could be up to three, I don't know.
All right.
So it's broken into three exhibitions covering artists from the 50 years. So the first one is only 7 years.
Yeah, dancers, musicians, artists.
All kinds of disciplines.
And some of the work that they created. And
I invited people that I never met before. I didn't know them. That was my process. And it's helped me.
Well, helped me too. I mean, I've been involved for years, and it's been an education.
Okay. I'd like to thank you, Ted, for showing your work and having the exhibition. I also would invite you to come and see it. And the New Arts Alive, that's it for today.
Thank you.
I thank you very much.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television. For more information about the New Arts Program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.